Good afternoon, everybody. You guys came out for this, you left the song and you came for us, so I appreciate that. So I'm going to try and leave you with four poems, and I'll start off with King of Men. Back when you were taken from our lives, like the Son of God ascending into heaven, to the barricade to another life, policemen on their motorbikes named you King of Men. You danced to toss grenades, all part of the charade in their fire ritual. In a restless air, we surrendered our weapons, accents, shank, short rope, blades, some poison, and all its animal understanding. Now fair game to the enemy with our world in their skull. They came down hills, during the blackout, phantoms from a falling sky. With years of practice at soft landings onto rooftops in darkness, like a spirit slipping into skin, the voice of their guns kept the violence from escaping. But the stillness in the trees can easily be mistaken for wind. Honey, I'm still free, take a chance on me, as the radio sings. The best thing I did was move my body from one side of the world to another. This required a visa, which required a bribe. The bribe placed in the palm of a man with a gun. It took my mother's monthly wage packets. The man with a gun let you speak to a clerk. He too wanted his wage, because it would be his job to have words with a judge for another month's salary. The official wanted his bribe, so listen to the clerk, escorted by the soldier as he held his gun. As I sat with my mother at the steps of the court drinking soda, waiting for one man to say yes, my mother said, in Uganda, a bribe stops a man from doing nothing. It rolls away the stone. Her sips were slower than mine, each separated by this prayer. I'm going to read you the title poem, Kingdom of Gravity. The book was initially called The Second Republic, which is what Uganda would have been called when they were trying to make a new constitution. But it ended up being called Kingdom of Gravity because this kind of poem kind of, there's always a poem, I think, that sings up above the others. I'm looking at my poem cousins over there, so they know what I'm talking about, and this was that poem. It kind of made me realize I was trying to elevate the perception of Uganda, Kingdom of Gravity. We are not Alexander, who conquered worlds, giving them new tongues. But we share a story of a ship resting on an African river, unbuckling at its shore, awakened by a night's cold, hard rain, staring at the face of the Nile as it reminds you, you are a hawk. Silence the voice of the midnight universe. And what makes a man name a city after himself, asking bricks to be bones, asking the wind to breathe like the lungs of a night, asking the nights to come closer to speak to you as a tribe, asking the tribe to sleep, asking sleep to loosen language, asking language to dream. Come close to me. Can you not see that I am in search of fire, the unshaken song of light? In my mouth is a name, hovering like smoke, spoken to me by the oracle. Like others, I was in search of a forest, a place to call home. What can I tell you about the kingdom? About having the world at your feet. When you have seen all of Earth's boundaries, you will crave for them in rivers, searching for them in streams. And when the river looks back at you, how can you be sure that nothing is lost? One of the early poems from the piece. Is this piece another link to you? And it's kind of, I'm interested to talk to you other poets, but there's always a poem that kind of locks what the tone of the book will be. And this was that poem, so it's called Beatitude. When a rebel leader promises you the world seen in commercials, he will hold a shotgun to the radio announcer's mouth and use a quart of whistling static to muffle the tears. When the crowds disperse, discarded like the husk of mangoes, he will weep with you in those hours of reckoning and judgment into a hollow night. When the crowds disperse, when by paraffin lights his whiskey breath tells you your mother's wailings and your father's bed are a song for our nation. As he sits with you on the veranda to witness the sunrise, say nothing. Slaughter your head. Feed the soldiers who looted your mills and factories. Let them dance in your garden while the old man watches. Then, when they sleep and your blood turns to kerosene, find your mother gathering water at the well to stave off the burning. Shave her head with a razor from the kiosk. When the fury has gathered, take her hand and run. Past the fields of odor of blood and bones, past the checkpoint, past the swamp, towards the smoky disk flaring at the horizon. Run till your knuckles become as white as handkerchiefs. Run into a night's fluorescent silence. Run till your lungs become a furnace of flames. Run past the border. Run till you no longer see yourself in other men's eyes. Run past sleep, past darkness visible. Stop when they find a country where nobody knows your name. I'll just read you one more poem and then I'll hand you over. And that poem is called Bird in Flame. It's the last poem that slid into the book. And I'm grateful for it because I struggled to write this poem. And it's about a famous archbishop who was, I won't give it away. Bird in Flames. What I need you to do is remember the bird. What do you have to remember?
The bird.
The kitschy guy. All right, okay. A man in his beer talks to another man after a swig of a dark bottle. His lips leak out. In the first death, I am a bird, darting from an oncoming pickup truck, under starlight, as I head for the grass, a static quiet. The pickup drives down the road. Two men mention genocide. A third struggles to confess that he has spoken to the tribes and it stirred a conflict. Earlier, a third man was blindfolded, hand resting at the bottleneck of his throat, a knife at his wrists, others surrounded him in a circle under a low purple light. Discomfort dripped from his mouth. They were looking for a reaction. The moment was disguised as a get-together, hence the beer, meat, and chapatis, and women's voices rising outside over music. The third man's arms are crossed as a deep voice enters the discussion and asks him, truthfully, Bishop, where are the arms? The night, it has an Indian heat. Silence moves the third man to his seat. A voice has set a table. He leans into the bishop's ear, rolls his sleeve, and invites him to join him once he's told him where the guns are. The guns. The guns. The bishop replies, I can live without your formality, without these courtesies. What meal have you prepared that I have not eaten? The voice kicks his chair out from under him. Back in the pickup, the bodies are not moving, no side glances. They pass a school, a settlement, a store, a trading post, into the hills, but there is no conversation. Notice the bird. The car's headlights are like fireflies. Since the moment has passed, I can tell you, there was no bird. But the men were real, and the table full of food. The only things missing are the bullets. A second death. That is how nations die over there. When I say nation, I mean tribe. When I say state, tribe, I mean people. And when I say over there, I mean here. Thank you.